I can juggle sometimes, but I'll probably drop them. So, you know. There we go. It's not gonna happen.
Welcome to Chemists in the Kitchen. Today we're going to be learning about making a traditional Chinese dessert that's called tofu pudding. And also we're going to talk about some substitutions that we're going to make to the recipe based on what we could find and a little bit about the science behind that. Hi, my name is Joan. I'm a conservation scientist, and that means that I study artist materials to understand how works of art were made, how they can change over time, so that we can better preserve them for future generations.
Hi everybody, my name's Robin. I'm a chemical engineer. Chemical engineers take chemistry and make it work big scale. So I used to do research on making plastics and changing plastic properties.
My name is Benny. I work with creating new materials for different function and characteristics depending on what the application it is. Currently, I am a professor at Los Angeles Pierce College teaching introductory chemistry. So the Chinese dessert that we'll be doing today in Cantonese is called Dòufuhuā, also known as the tofu pudding. The reason I picked this dish is because this is one of my comfort food. When I was a little kid, I went to the wet market and usually that's where they sell this tofu pudding or Dòufuhuā. And I always crave for it because they're always, so fresh and tastes really good.
And when I was a kid, we didn't have that much dessert in the house. So every Sunday night as a special treat, we would get instant chocolate pudding. That was our weekly dessert. So I'm especially excited to learn another comfort pudding that I can make.
Do you want me to just make up a story? I could just make up a story.
Joan once went on a quest to get pudding or something.
Yes, yes. In the great pudding bowl of the 1930s, I was out prospecting and came across the borax mud flats in southern Arizona. So I also love to cook and bake, and I am a vegetarian. And so having a good working knowledge of appropriate substitutions is really, really helpful when you're trying to modify a recipe to make it work for you. And also, as a chemist, I also really like understanding the chemistry of what's happening when I'm cooking or baking, because that, again, helps me solve a problem if something's not working when I'm cooking. Or if I need to make a weird substitution because I can't find something, I can use my chemical knowledge to find something that might work, that works in the same way.
All right, Benny, I'm excited to try this out. Let's get cooking.
So in order to make the tofu pudding, first you need cornstarch, 1 teaspoon of gypsum, also known as calcium sulfate. Of course, you cannot not have the soy milk. Okay, so I bought this fresh soy milk from an Asian market.
Made my soy milk from scratch last night.
Awesome. So let's prepare the gelling agent first. So let's add the gypsum and the cornstarch into a thick bowl. 1 teaspoon of the gypsum.
How much water do we add?
Good question. We need about 40 mls of water.
Now's the time for all the Americans to convert that into cups. That's about 1 2/3 cups.
Are you sure about that,
no.
Robin, that you did
no.
40 milliliters?
No.
This should be like between 2 and 3 ounces.
What? Oh, yeah. 40 milliliters.
Yeah.
So it's more like 3 tablespoons. Conversion issues.
So once you have the water, add it to the, the mixture.
But the cornstarch is not going to dissolve. And I don't know how soluble calcium sulfate is. It's a little water soluble, but it's not really, really water soluble. So do you think that's going into solution or not?
I agree. The solubility is not that high, but right now you have this mixture. And then right before we're going to pour in the soy milk, we will have to mix it again. Right now, I'm just going to make sure that all the clumps disappear. So now then the next part is to heat up the soy milk. What we're going to do now is we're going to wait for the soy milk to heat it to about 90 degrees Celsius. Okay, so right now we can just wait for the soy milk to heat up.
The most fun part of cooking.
It looks like I hit 90, you guys. ready.
So now if your solvent is ready, go back and look at your gelling agent again. Make sure you mix them really well. And now we're gonna do the pouring of the soy milk.
Looks like it's already gelling. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, you can tell it feels kind of thick.
If you have a cover, you can cover it and then let it sit for, you know, 15 to 30 minutes, then it will just gel and set. So while we're waiting for the tofu pudding to set, what we're gonna do is we're gonna make the sauce, because when you just use a fresh soy milk, basically they are not sweet. In terms of the ingredient, you'll need ginger. If you have brown sugar, that would be better. And then water. So first, let's get one cup of water and put it in the saucepan, and then add the sugar and the ginger.
So I made my ginger syrup ahead of time because I wanted to eat it on, try it ahead of time. Sorry.
If you want more spiciness, then you can always, you know, add more ginger. So in terms of the sugar, you can start with 1 tablespoon.
How much sugar did you use, Robin?
Oh, I used a lot of sugar. I have a major sweet tooth. I used a hard brown sugar. What's it called? Panela, I think. Comes in a brick.
So you put just a whole brick of sugar?
Basically.
Sigh.
When I was making my syrup, it was starting to boil towards the end, and like you can boil it so much that it gets too hard, right? Like regular sugar can turn into hard candy. So you want to be careful not to cook it too long. Unless you just want to crack ginger candy on top of your pudding.
That might work too. I don't know.
It might work. Yeah.
So I could not find the nice fresh soy milk that Benny was using, and I didn't really want to take the time and effort to make my own fresh soy milk like Robin did. But when I was at the grocery store, I took a really hard look at the ingredient labels, and I was able to find 2 brands of soy milk on the shelf that in their ingredients just list water and soybean. Both of these were not in the refrigerated section. These were both shelf-stable products. It doesn't say on these packages any specific details about the processing, but in some cases for that kind of, you know, commercial processing for a shelf-stable product, the material might go through something called ultra-high temperature flash pasteurization. So that means that the milk product is exposed to a very high heat source for a very brief time. And that's enough to kill any pathogens, so that's good. So it's a nice, safe product that you can sell to people. For my substitution, I'm going to try citric acid. But if you don't have powdered citric acid, it's present in lemon juice at fairly high concentrations. So I think for the amount that we're using, 1 teaspoon, the equivalent of that for this recipe would be about 3 ounces of lemon juice. I'm gonna go ahead and add my pure powder, and I have the cornstarch already in here. Now the citric acid, once we add the 40 milliliters of water, the citric acid will actually dissolve. And the same way as we followed in the first recipe, we're gonna heat up the soy milk. It does make you appreciate the cooking shows where they just be like, and here it is.
They're going to go on a low shelf in the oven for 30 minutes. And there you go.
Yeah, I kind of do wonder how much the heating of the soy milk affects this. Like, I think probably with the first one, it's helping the calcium sulfate get into solution a little bit more.
But I think the heating may also help to denature the protein, and then so that would change the structure of the protein, and then so that may also help the calcium or magnesium ion to bind to the protein.
Well, something definitely happens.
So while we wait for those to set up, let's turn to Robin and see her substitution.
Okay, so for my first time making this tofu pudding recipe, I decided to go all out and make my own soy milk from scratch. But I don't normally do that. I normally use commercial soy milk. So when I was thinking about this recipe, I was thinking about what I could do that would use commercial soy milk. And my first thought was cornstarch. But there's something about the flavor of cornstarch that I don't totally love. So I was thinking about other gelling agents that might work instead. And I thought about agar powder. It's like a seaweed-derived gelling agent that usually replaces gelatin. So it might be a little bit firmer than a cornstarch pudding, but I thought it would be worth giving it a shot. So for my recipe, it's very simple. 2 cups of either homemade or store-bought soy milk, and then 1 teaspoon of agar powder. So agar doesn't dissolve, it doesn't create its gel until it's been heated pretty significantly. Depending on whether you get the powder or the flakes, you're cooking it for anywhere between 2 to 10 minutes. But the cool thing about agar, it's a crazy amount of fiber because it comes from algae. So all right, so I'm gonna use my commercial soy milk for this one. And this one, you're just gonna put the agar, 1 teaspoon of agar directly in your cooking pot.
So I have, I think what you say, the seaweed version of the agar, how much do you think I should put in? Definitely not the whole thing.
Yeah, I would maybe do like a palm full.
Let me add a little bit.
Yeah, the agar is pretty, so like it's jiggly.
I think the gelation point of agar is specific to a temperature. So it's like until it cools down sufficiently, the gel is not gonna fully set up.
The word patience means to wait in a calm way.
Yeah.
So normally, if you know you make a good tofu pudding, is do the spoon test. You know, so if your spoon will just, you know, sit without sinking into the pudding, then you know it's good. So I guess one way we can test it for each one is to see if they can withstand the spoon test.
Great test, I love it.
The spoon test passes. So we've made all 3 puddings, and we've talked about how they're different, and there's only one thing left to do, and that's eat these delicious puddings. Let's do it.
No.
So the texture of mine on top is really ugly, but the bottom looks really nice and smooth. Beginner's mistake, I guess, on the top. The texture of this one is pretty amazing. It's like silky smooth.
So Benny, is this something that you would eat warm, or would you let it chill and have it cold?
You can actually do both, you know, so depend, summertime, maybe chill is better because it's more refreshing. And then for the winter time, you may want to like eat it when it's hot. So it's really depending on what you like.
It's really good. How did yours turn out, Benny?
Yeah, very, very fluffy, smooth. It withstand the spoon test, so I think that's good. Personally, I think it's a little bit too much water in today's batch, but I think that's because of the soy milk that I'm using.
Okay, well, I think I'm ready to try the citric acid one. I have a feeling this is going to be very differently successful. But there's some firmness here. I'm going to see if it passes the spoon test.
Yeah, mine definitely passed the spoon test.
Yeah, shocked that mine is passing the spoon test right now.
I feel like this one has more texture. It's not as smooth as the first one, the original recipe.
That the lemoniness is not as overpowering as I was afraid it would be. I thought it would be like really, really sour. So the protein is reacting differently to the acidic conditions than it does to the calcium ions in the gypsum. And so I think, yeah, it's kind of making these curds just because it's going through a different kind of coagulation pathway. It's not bad though. I thought it would be horrible. I really thought it would be like awful.
Yeah, and it's more fun to experiment in the kitchen because you get to eat it, right?
Well, the good and the bad.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I think this one doesn't even need a spoon test. I think you can just kind of...
Yeah, I think mine's maybe ready to try.
Yeah, I think it's definitely like prettier than the other ones.
This one's definitely chewier than the others. Just not that surprising since it's a kind of a gelatin replacement, but... Very bouncy.
Yeah, the textural difference is probably a much bigger shock for Benny because he knows how it's supposed to be. And so this is like, this is not that.
So I think I do a lot of substitutions, and usually it's because I don't have something. You know, if a recipe calls for buttermilk and I don't have buttermilk, I use yogurt or something. So I think the most important thing with substitutions is just understanding the function it plays in the recipe. And in this case, we needed to know how each gel was being set up and what we could replace that would make sense, right? So
yeah, absolutely. I agree with that. I think, you know, there's just such a lot of room to experiment.
Well, thank you both so much. As an engineer, I don't always know my chemistry, so it was great to hear your perspectives on how these things work. And I love talking to you guys, and I look forward to many new adventures in the kitchen.
Maybe next time we can try, you know, you guys' recipe. You know? So I show you one of mine. Next time you should, you know, Joan or Robin, show me your recipe, and then I can think about how I can make substitution too.
So when we pack up the production kits, where do we pack the tofu pudding? Where do you want that?